first second you realize you have a problem. And then you have to go all the way back to all of your training, all of your experience, everything that you've ever read and learned. And you have to troubleshoot your problem that one second. Your second second you use to execute your decision based on all that information.
Okay.
Your third second is all dead time because you're going to find out whether you made a bad decision or not. And
but that's the truth.
That's the truth. And when you're moving at the speeds that we move in passenger service, I will say this, and we can use this place for an example. If you were to get out of your chair and walk over to that Dutch door,
okay,
I can move the length of 8 football fields.
Wow.
So I don't have a lot of time to think. In freight, you normally think a mile and a half behind you because the length of your train and clearing out any restrictions, interlockings, sidings, and things like that.
Right.
Passenger service, you're thinking a mile to 2 miles ahead of you because by the time you think about where you're going, you're almost there.
Hey, this is DJ from DJ's Trains on YouTube, and I had the pleasure of interviewing engineer Bill Broadus, one of the coolest, most interesting people I've ever met. With over 40 years experience, you're going to hear some great stories. Here we are at the Keystone and Lehigh Valley Model Railroad Club with our friend Steve, who I've also interviewed as an engineer. So sit back and enjoy this first of a couple videos with engineer Bill.
So you were telling me about all the different type of engines, because, I mean, you got to remember, you're back in, what, I wouldn't say first generation, or would those be first generation?
We had first generation diesel locomotives, RS3Ms, the DeWitt Jeeps,
okay.
RS1s,
okay.
We had S2s, we had Jeep 7s, Jeep 9s from the ICG.
High nose?
Yes, high nose, Paducah rebuilds. We had the CF7s from the Santa Fe.
Yeah. He said Santa Fe this time.
Yes.
On record.
On record. We had the SSB 1200s.
What's that?
That was a San Bernardino shop rebuild of SW7s and SW8s and 9s. They made them SSB 1200s.
So if you look back at your whole career, what was your favorite? What belongs in the junk pile?
Well, I would say the SSB 1200 559 was the Cadillac of the Santa Fe equipment that we got.
Okay.
And we got the Santa Fe locomotives, those yard engines, in exchange for the SDP 40Fs.
Oh, okay.
So that was a deal with the Santa Fe that they would exchange those rebuilds with our SDP 40Fs.
Hmm.
We had a lot of derailment problems with the SDP 40Fs. There's just a lot of areas they couldn't go. And so the F40 became the champion.
Okay.
The other six axle that we had was the P30CH by GE.
Okay.
Six axle GEs. Same control stand as an E60 CP, but it was a diesel. Now, the interesting thing about that particular locomotive, the P30s were the only Amtrak engines that you could successfully pair the two HEP engines and put them in working together.
Okay.
So we were talking about the P30s that you could match up the HEP units. And they were the only Amtrak engines you could do that with. So they would run three of those on the auto train.
Oh, okay.
So they each had two HEP generators on them. So they would have all six in line.
Okay.
To power the train. And they said that 10 P-30s with both their HEP units online could power all of Washington, D.C.
Okay, so that's, I've talked about that before, that a engine, really, it's a diesel engine, but it creates electricity.
Correct.
And yes, if there was, that, I've seen this on the news where they've used an engine to power after a tornado or hurricane.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. The locomotive with the diesel engine, it turns the generator, and the generator makes electricity. And that's how a diesel engine normally operates with the AR-10 and the companion alternator sending electricity to the traction motors.
Yeah.
So that's some of the equipment that I had a chance to operate.
Okay.
Again, the GG1s, they were fading out. in 83.
So you did get to drive a GG1.
I got to be on them. I was in freight in 83 when I came to Amtrak in 84. They had taken them off. Jersey Transit was the last one to operate those.
Okay.
Because the AM7 was brand new.
Okay.
So they wanted us all to be on the AM7.
They call them toasters?
Yes, the toasters are Swedish meatballs. That's what they used to call them. ASEA was a company, and they called them Swedish meatballs. And what happened, they were built by EMD. The parts were sent over, and then EMD assembled the AM7s. We had different types of air brake. We had number 6, number 8, 14, 24, 26, and then 30 CDW, which is the console desk WABCO, was the latest version. And that was on the AM7.
Now, how would you describe it for someone that's not familiar with a lot of those terms?
Well, the different positions for the air brakes, based on the schedule, what we call the air brake schedule. So number 6 would be equivalent to a steam engine brake. That was like the first generation type of air brake. And then number 8 and 14 and 24 were little better variations of that. The 24s were most commonly used on the F units and the E units and the GG1s.
Okay.
26 came about, which now became a self-lapping. So there was no lap position where you make a reduction on the previous air brake stands. You'd make a reduction, you have to put it in the lap to hold your reduction right where you wanted it. Okay. 26, with the advent of self-lapping brake, I can make a 10-pound reduction on my brake pipe and it will hold it at that 10-pound reduction. Right. Plus it had a pressure maintaining feature that would hold it exactly where I needed it.
Did you ever have a train get away from me?
Close. And I will say this.
Brakes release on you?
I had a brake failure my third trip.
Of course, after I got promoted. Yes.
And I was over 100 miles an hour. I did a running brake test. I did everything I was supposed to do, proper brake test. And what happened was the control valve hung up on the first coach behind the engine. So I had 9 cars shoving my meatball.
Okay.
And I have a thing that I teach all my students. It's called the 3-second rule.
Okay.
And that 3-second rule is the first second you realize you have a problem. And then you have to go all the way back to all of your training, all of your experience, everything that you've ever read and learned. And you have to troubleshoot your problem that 1 second. Your second, you use to execute your decision based on all that information.
Okay.
Your 3rd second is all dead time because you're going to find out whether you made a bad decision or not. And
but that's the truth.
That's the truth. And when you're moving at the speeds that we move in passenger service, I will say this, and we can use this place for an example. If you were to get out of your chair and walk over to that Dutch door, I can move the length of 8 football fields.
Wow.
So I don't have a lot of time to think. In freight, you normally think a mile and a half behind you because the length of your train and clearing out any restrictions, interlockings, sidings, and things like that.
Right.
Passenger service, you're thinking 1 to 2 miles ahead of you because by the time you think about where you're going, you're almost there.
Wow.
So there's a big difference. Now, passenger is not any better than freight as far as the engineer's perspective. And what I mean by that, bad things can happen no matter what service. You don't really get a break working one versus the other. They each have their own set of skill sets. And
whether you're carrying human life or explosives.
Exactly.
Right, there's still that same kind of pressure.
Absolutely,
on you.
Absolutely. Right. And the thing is, as far as stopping a train, we talked about brakes earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Passenger train takes about 1.5 to 2 miles to stop, based on the speed, the length, type of equipment, weather conditions. Freight's the same way.
Yeah.
So again, and I teach this to all of my students, I ask them to take a dime out of their pocket. And some of them will pull out a dime, and I says, now you see that dime? If you were to place it down on the ground and stand up and look at it, that's how much of the wheel actually touches the rail at any given time, whether you're standing or in motion. That's it.
Yeah.
As big as those wheels are, 52-inch wheels on some of our electric engines, That's all you're getting as far as contact surface.
Right.
There's the importance for sand.
Right.
All right, so most people would say, well, why do you need sand? Well, for adhesion. If I'm in emergency brake application, I need that sand to act as resistance mm-hmm. to help slow me down rather than smooth metal on metal contact.
Right.
When I'm accelerating or maybe decelerating, those automatic sanders provide some type of friction so I don't have that wheel slip
yeah.
and wheel slide. And you and I have probably have worked more times where we've run over leaves and we get excessive wheel slip because
correct.
Of the
yes.
oil that's secreted from the leaves.
Yeah.
And as big as those locomotives are, as heavy as they are, and you figure a Dash 9 holds, what, about 20 tons of fuel alone?
Okay.
5,000 gallon tank.
Yeah.
Because a gallon of yeah. diesel is, what, 8 pounds a gallon?
Yeah.
So you figure 20 tons of fuel on a locomotive, and your gross weight for a locomotive, 250 tons per locomotive, and you're still having wheel slip.
Yeah.
So as big as the equipment is, it's still sensitive to certain nuances based on weather conditions, mm-hmm. rail conditions, sleet.
Yeah, snow doesn't affect us.
No.
Ice affects us.
Yeah. And the other thing is, what used to be an issue, you run freight trains all night. Mm-hmm. And where I used to operate on the main line of the passenger train, I'd come out of the terminal, and all that exhaust from all those diesel engines, if they spit oil all over the rail, and I have the early morning dew coming out, mm-hmm. I have excessive wheel slip.
Yeah.
Because the rails are coated from all those freight trains. Oil coming out of the exhaust, and it doesn't take much, just
yeah.
particles of oil, and it accumulates, and you have dew on the rail, excessive wheel slip.
Be sure to subscribe to my channel, DJ's Trains, because I have more videos with Bill. He talks about taking trains into Canada and putting them in a cage. Dealing with earthquakes, and just things you don't think about. You're going to love the next series of videos.
Have you hit a car?